For the past 2 years, we've been talking about the potential for diamond in health sciences and the things that you could do with diamond if you built structures and if you could control the doping. Today's speaker, Dr. Ron Walsworth, is going to tell us about what you can do. We talked about the future. The future is here. Dr. Walsworth is from the Department of Astrophysics in Harvard University. He is widely published and has been working in precision measurements in astrophysics. He's been working on the search for planets, the search for planets with life, possibly. He's worked in some really interesting new concept in nuclear magnetic resonance imaging. And today he's going to talk to us about what you can do with diamond vacancy centers and other ways of detecting, doing magnetic resonance in diamond. Dr. Walsworth.
Thanks, Bob. Okay, so I'm a physicist. Sometimes I say lock the door now before everybody runs out. And I'll try to tone down the sort of physics angle on things a little bit, but I do want to make the general point that there is a very healthy interface between the physical sciences, physics, and the life sciences, particularly in the area and pushing the state of the art of measurement technology, how to measure basic things and develop tools for precision measurements. This is relevant, of course, to physics, but many of the tools that are developed in the physical sciences can be very important in the life sciences as well. And recently, Harvard has spent a large chunk of its still large but dwindling amount of money to build a large building called the Northwest Building. It's called the Northwest Building. It doesn't have somebody's name attached to it yet because no donor, I think, has given some hundreds of millions of dollars to it. So if there's anybody here who wants their name attached to a building, Bob, you can probably sign that $400 million check or something like that. Anyhow, this Harvard's Northwest Building is a large building dedicated to interface between the life sciences and the physical sciences and engineering. And so there's systems biology, neuroscience, stem cells, all that sort of good stuff going on in there, as well as funny, pointy-headed physicists like myself who are hopefully developing new technologies that can be relevant to life scientists. Taking some of the things that we've done in the physical sciences for atomic clocks and other sorts of tools and applying them. So a person like me, faculty member there, has a research group, maybe 10 or 15 people. My group is particularly interdisciplinary. We get graduate students and postdocs whose training is in disciplines like physics or astrophysics, engineering, biophysics, chemistry. I've had MD, PhD students as well. And for the better part of 15 years, I've not only been working in basic fundamental physics, but also thinking about this interface and spin-offs that can occur over into the life sciences. And we develop tools. Our forte is developing tools for precision measurements and then applying them widely. We do things like develop atomic clocks to test the fundamental laws of physics. We develop special laser tools which enhance the capabilities of telescopes which are searching for Earth-like planets around other stars. We do fundamental quantum optics and optical physics. And we also take some of those same tools and figure out ways that they can be applied in biomedical and bioimaging. And this is what I'm going to talk to you about today, how some of these tools that come from basic physics have been successfully transitioned already into human biomedical imaging, and then this frontier area in taking these atom-like defects which exist in diamond, and which Apollo Diamond and Bob Lanars and others are at the frontier in terms of making, fabricating, and how these are a really promising tool for being able to do nanoscale MRI in living cells. So that is measuring the magnetic fields that exist in living cells, but now at the nanoscale. What we try to do with the tools we make is attack important problems. We do things like test theories that attempt to unify relativity and quantum mechanics at the frontier of fundamental physics. We're searching for Earth-like planets around other stars, as I said. We're learning about new ways to manipulate matter at the nanoscale. And we also, across this boundary, think about new sorts of imaging tools for medicine and biology. There's a lot of synergy here. It's not just a one-way street. The problems that we confront thinking in this realm also inform what we can do for the physical sciences as well. For example, the atomic clocks that have been built in our lab are the clocks that are used by NASA as part of their deep space tracking network. So how does NASA navigate the spacecraft that are out there flying to Mars and Jupiter and places like that? They have atomic clocks on board and atomic clocks situated around the world, and there's radio signals which are sent to and from the spacecraft or from Earth to the spacecraft and back. And the time of flight it takes those radio pulses measured with atomic clocks gives you the distance. The Doppler shift in the signal gives you the relative speed, and the differential arrival time of the signals at different stations on the Earth gives you the angle in the sky. So atomic clocks, there's a picture of one built in our lab, so-called hydrogen masers, are located in the deserts in California, Spain, and Australia, where they have these large antennae which both send and receive signals. Atomic clocks built in our lab, reconfigured versions of what I've just described, have been used on board spacecraft to test some of the fundamental predictions of Einstein's theory of relativity. And they've been used in laboratories, in my laboratory at the Center for Astrophysics, to do the best search ever performed for whether there is a preferred frame to our universe. Or is our universe isotropic? All of these sorts of measurements involve magnetic resonance of gases. They involve making measurements of the rate at which little magnetic moments, which are inside of individual atoms, the rate at which these magnetic moments spin in magnetic fields. And that form of magnetic resonance is not all that different from the magnetic resonance which is involved in doing MRI. When you go to a hospital and a doctor wants to take an MRI image of the inside of your body. So MRI, sometimes also called NMR for nuclear magnetic resonance, so magnetic resonance imaging or nuclear magnetic resonance, you can kind of think of it coming in two primary forms traditionally. One are the kind of vertical bore high field magnets that you find in chemistry departments, in these metal cans like this. And the other you may be familiar with are these large superconducting magnets with big holes in them into which they slide your body, from which they can make these beautiful MRI images. Conventional hospital MRI involves putting a person in this tight tube, typically with some coils around some part of their body to radiate them with radio waves and then detect these magnetic resonance signals. Of course, there's wonderfully detailed images that can be created. If you ask the question, how does it work? You have to go back to the 1800s. With Michael Faraday, there's an early daguerreotype photo of Michael Faraday from the 1830s or 40s. And so the transition took over about 150 years to go from the basic physics discoveries of Faraday's law of induction all the way to MRI machines, where Faraday discovered that if you have a magnet and you move it in and out of a coil of wire, a voltage is created. That voltage is a signal that tells you about the motion of the magnet. This time-varying magnetization induces a voltage and a signal that you can detect. This sort of effect is now commonly used in many of our technologies. By just after World War II, Felix Bloch at Stanford and Edward Purcell and Bob Pound at Harvard discovered that bulk matter, like your body and liquid water like found here, et cetera, has a form of magnetism in it, not just somewhat like the little bar magnets that we know, but a naturally occurring kind of magnetism that comes from the nuclei inside of the atoms and molecules in most matter. And when you place bulk matter inside of a large magnetic field and you apply the right kind of radio frequency pulses, it's very much the same as Faraday causing little magnets to move in and out of a coil, and you can get a signal and detect a voltage. That signal comes now, though, from the individual atoms and molecules, the nuclei inside the atoms and molecules in your body. And a key fact is that the frequency of those signals are proportional, linearly proportional to the strength of the applied magnetic field. And given that fact, one can develop the ability to do imaging. It's a simple fact. The rate of frequency depends upon the strength of the magnetic field. So here's how it works. It took, of course, something like another 30 years to go from the discovery of NMR in bulk matter to imaging, but the underlying concept is very simple. Let's say you have some object you want to image, like this funny-looking jellyfish that I show here. This is your NMR sample. If you put it in a static magnetic field, which varies with position, so the strength is increasing as you go in this direction, and you measure the magnetism, the precessing magnetization and Faraday effect as a function of frequency, you'll see that the magnitude of the signal as a function of frequency maps directly onto the amount of stuff as a function of position. Because the magnetic field is varying linearly in this direction, that means the NMR frequency is varying in this direction. That's the rate at which the nuclear magnetic moments are precessing. And therefore, you can reconstruct from this information of the magnitude of signal as a function of frequency, how much stuff there is as a function of position, and from that make an image. As long as you put the gradients along all three directions. It's really as simple as that conceptually. Of course, it's very complicated and very involved in an engineering point of view to make it work well. But making it work well is no mean feat and led to Lauterbur and Mansfield a few years ago winning the Nobel Prize. So this development from Faraday to Bloch and Purcell to Lauterbur and Mansfield and many other people who contributed along the way is a great example of the transition from learning how to make basic measurements of physical processes and applying them over into imaging for biology and medicine. However, conventional MRI of body tissues, though it works for many parts of the body, is ineffective for certain things. It's ineffective for the lungs, for example, because the lungs are about 90% gas space. So the air which is inside your lungs is very low density, and though they have a little bit of magnetic moments there, there just isn't enough to give you much of a signal. It's also rather ineffective for when you have very rare molecular scale processes. If you're just trying to measure the bulk anatomy of the body, MRI is good for rare processes or empty spaces like the lungs, not so good. And so this is what led me and several other people in the physics and chemistry community about 15 to 20 years ago to come up with this concept of not just taking advantage of the naturally occurring magnetic moments which exist in the atoms and molecules in your body, but adding something to it, that is ingesting media, which we call hyperpolarized media, media which are pre-magnetized. Benign things you can put into your body, pre-magnetized, which can allow you to image those parts of the body which aren't easy to image because there are things like lungs, which are empty spaces. Some of the most common and most successful of the hyperpolarized media are the noble gases helium-3 and xenon-129. They have been used for about 15 years quite successfully. I'll just tell you a few things about them. There are also some newer emerging media like silicon nanoparticles that I won't get into in this talk, but the basic idea is that you want to have a benign substance pre-magnetized that you can place into the body and can make up for the inadequacies of the naturally occurring tissue. In particular, helium and xenon are special in ways that are going to turn out to be true for the nitrogen vacancy centers in diamond in a few minutes when I get to talking about them. They're noble gases, which means they have closed electron shells protecting and isolating the nuclei inside. And those nuclei sit with a nuclear spin, which is like a little magnetic moment, nicely protected inside the closed electron shells. The fact they have a nuclear spin gives them, makes them act like a magnet, gives them a signal that you can detect with Faraday through Faraday's law of induction. But the closed electron shell isolates for them from their environment so that this spin polarization, when you line all of the nuclei up in the same direction, can last for very long periods of time. Hours in clean glass chambers, and several minutes, even when inhaled inside of the body or taken in vivo.